Okay, good afternoon, everybody. 6:46, bringing the meeting to order. Apologies for the delay. Additional issues in closed session item. City Attorney?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Council met in closed session and discussed items A through D on the closed session agenda. Direction was given. No reportable action was taken. Items E and F are continued until after the open session. Thank you.
Thank you, City Attorney. City Clerk, note that all members of the council are present. We can go with the Pledge of Allegiance. Hildy, will you lead us, please?
Ready, begin.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Good to see you here at the council meeting, Hildy. All right. Motion to approve the agenda?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, motion by Mr. Moreno, second by Mayor Pro Tem Hurtado. Please press the button to display your vote. Can you get a toggle switch here that just says yes, no, abstain?
What is it?
Almost there.
This is incredible. If you get Pecos telling me to work, it got a bad light up there.
There you go. Okay, 5-0. Okay, now we're going to go to presentations. Presentation by Mrs. Cristina Abeja Rochelle, AARP Community Action Team Coordinator for Imperial County.
It's right there.
Good evening. As Mr. Romero said, I am Cristina Abeja Rochelle, and I am the AARP CPT leader for the Imperial Valley. My main issue in this life is work, volunteering, 10% volunteer for senior citizens. That is one of the most vulnerable issues in this country. The seniors need lots of attention from us. And because all the work we have been doing, because we are about 5 or 6 volunteers only for Imperial County, the group was selected by the University of Berkeley last February to receive one award for being one of the best volunteers in California working for seniors. I mention working because that's what we do, but we volunteer, we don't have any salary because we love seniors. Because seniors is what they need, our love. We don't see them as a business. We don't charge them anything. We are here to serve senior citizens in the Imperial Valley. And that's our main homework in this area, helping them with their English skills, telling them to become citizens. And now we are working with Sacramento in the AB 1560 that will allow low-income persons and low-income seniors to have a special card so they can cover their food, their nutrition, and if they have some money left for their clothes. That's part of our work. I brought the appreciation that I received from Berkeley that was given to me, but it's not mine. It's for you, for the seniors. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Ms. Ocean.
Thank you, Cristina. I thought it was important that Cristina come in. She impressed me very much at a meeting we had when we saw her at the Hotel De Anza, and I thought that she was a very spunky, very energetic, active senior citizen in our community, and just shows exactly how active all our seniors are here in the community. So thank you very much, and congratulations, Cristina. You needed to show that off. Congratulations. Let me go ahead and read that. Her award says, University of California, Berkeley, School of Public Health, and the California Wellness Foundation, California Senior Leadership Award goes to Christina Abeja Hoschnell in recognition of outstanding contributions to healthy aging, community building, and social justice, February 25th, 2012. Just hope that we all get to that point in our lives and be as active as you are, Christina. Congratulations.
Thank you, Christina. Okay. Presentation by Arts Commission. I guess where this is where you come in, Hilda.
Go ahead and pass that down. Good evening, Council. The Calexico Arts Commission consists of, I'm supposed to just give you an update.
Yes.
Consists of five commissioners individually appointed by each council member presently. I serve as chairperson of the commission, and I was appointed by Councilman Hodge. For most of this past year, 2011, 2012, we have been working with four commissioners due to the fact that one of our young commissioners resigned. Then early part of this year, 2012, another commissioner, due to his change of profession or job issues, also resigned. So, on the commission for the past few months have been Commissioner Sonia Salazar and Judith Mason and I. It's my understanding that council will appoint two new commissioners, and we look forward to working with them and making the commission a five-member one, as it should be. The commission is under the direction and supervision of City Community Services Director Sandra Towler. We meet the first Monday of every month at 5:30 p.m. either here at City Hall or at the Calexico Cultural Arts Center. But in special cases like today, for instance, our meeting this month will be next Monday, June 11th at the Cultural Arts Center. Because of the many projects we have going on throughout the year, we also have subcommittees and we meet on off days depending on the upcoming event. So normally on a good month, we meet at least three times, the general meeting open to the public and then the subcommittee meetings. We have an array of events to promote, including to promote the arts, including the annual black and white art exhibit, the fantasy exhibit, which included prison art and installation. Last October, when the Chamber of Commerce hosted the John Lennon tribute Beatles concert, we tied in a Beatles art exhibit and collectible show the Thursday before the Saturday night concert. This past Saturday and all this week, we have the women's art exhibit going on, which we tied in with Camp Live Your Dream that was organized by Seroptimus International of Calexico. It involved junior high girls students, and the morning camp was held at SDSU Calexico campus, and then they walked over to the Cultural Arts Center to view the women's art that is on exhibit until Thursday. The Arts Commission has also been working with Theater Arts and mainly Roy Dorantes in his productions of To Cross the Border and What is Love. We have made a commitment to him to continue bringing theater arts to Calexico, and this way we can help each other until the two actors on the city council decide to give up the political bandwagon. We will be working strictly with Roy Dorantes because you guys are busy doing something else. During the Mariachi Festival, the Arts Commission was involved in the tryout process for the 2012 Mariachi Idol competition, bringing in the performing and music aspect of the arts. We were also instrumental in the planning and scheduling of the three-day Cultural Arts Center Mariachi Festival Artesanías in Mexico de Mexico, which included artisans from Baja California and other parts of Mexico, as well as participation with the Mexican Consulate in bringing the Ballet Folklorico del Estado de Baja California. We worked with bringing in the other mariachi groups and other musical musicians such as Patricia Hurtado, who is local. The Arts Commission also assisted in the introduction of the newest mariachi in the Imperial Valley by the name of Mariachi Acero del Valle, which has only been together for these last 2 months, and we were able to include them in the arts events at the Cultural Arts Center and the actual festival at Crummett Park. One of the new events we added this year was the first annual Children's Arts Festival, which was held on Saturday, May the 12th. This came up after Sandra Towler and I went to seek an answer as to why our children's art exhibit wasn't successful. So on a Saturday back in October, we went to the City of Yuma Children's Arts Festival and watched as hundreds of children participated in creating art, and all the schools from kindergarten to high school held an exhibit inside their gallery in downtown Yuma. We held ours with the support of various service clubs and schools, and it turned out fabulous. The art on exhibit was very well made, creative, attractive, interesting. The art stations outside were fun, messy, and positive. We can count about between 200 to 250 people approximately, and we were sure that it will triple those numbers next year. The Arts Commission has also assisted the Historical Commission, Mr. Herrera, during their last presentation at the Cultural Arts Center, as well as the Ed White Drawing Painting Workshop held during the Rock the Border Arts Exhibit and Music Fest. We also dabbled in film as we participated in the film forward screening of an Australian film that was also part of a Camarena Memorial Library project. The film included the actor Jeffrey Rush, and the actual director of the film was present to answer questions and chit-chat with all the members present. It was so good, I can't remember the name of the movie, but it reminded me of the film that came out years ago, The Gods Must Be Crazy. So it was kind of in that genre. On the agenda for our upcoming Monday meeting, we are discussing projects with a new organization. It's the Veterans in the Arts organization that wants to be more involved with the Arts Commission and the Cultural Arts Center and use our gallery space. We are also speaking with Clark Baker and other artists from Imperial Valley and bringing back the Imperial County Arts Council and work out a plan as to how the cities can work together. Also on Monday, we will be discussing the Think Pink art exhibit that we want to hold in October in observance of Breast Cancer Month. We would like to include photographs, paintings, collage, sculpture, installation, performing arts, projecting what is breast cancer, what is Think Pink. These specific exhibits have to be publicized with plenty of time for artists to get ready and get ideas. So after the Monday meeting, we will have a date and call for art going out immediately. I just mentioned several of the projects that we have worked on and are or will be working on. The Arts Commission, all three of us, and hopefully all five of us, and our fearless leader, Sandra Towler, we organize the events, we meet, we hang the shows, we set up the displays, we make the announcements, we help spread the cheese on the crackers, we donate the wine and meet and greet for all of the artist receptions and openings, etc. We dismantle the shows, are there when artists come to drop off and pick up, we are there when a show is going on to open and close the Cultural Arts Center. We clean up, we vacuum, we sweep, we mop, we clean restrooms, we close doors, and when we can't handle it anymore, we'll call in a carpet cleaner and give it a good shampoo. But that's, you know, because that costs money, so that's the last thing we do. We are selling tote bags and t-shirts with a design that Sandra and I came up with to raise money for a sign indicating where the Cultural Arts Center is. A piece of sculpture made with wrought iron, a mural on the wall at the entrance, a mosaic. There are many ways this sign idea can be attacked, and we are working on it. So the fact that we lost a couple of commissioners might come to blame because there is a lot of extra work once you become part of the Arts Commission. And I think that, you know, people just get tired and they get too tired to continue. You have to love the arts, and the arts are usually very messy, so lots of cleanup is involved. This is all I have. I just that those of us on the commission truly enjoy what we are doing. Your city staffer, Sandra Towler, is always open to ideas and willing to assist us, along as sometimes we can get a little crazy. The arts is a positive tool for the city of Calexico. It brings artists from all over Imperial County, San Diego, Julian, Mexicali, and Tijuana. The news reports of our events are always positive and bring good publicity to the city. The Cultural Arts Center is visited by many family members, students, and spouses of the many artists. In May, Congressman Bob Filner held his 51st Congressional District Art Competition for Valley High Schools at the Calexico Cultural Arts Center. There were over 200 people in attendance from all over the valley. So, on behalf of the Arts Commission, This is our update to you so you can see how busy we are, and if you have any suggestions that you can make to us, or if there's something you want to see that we haven't covered as much, please let us know. Do you have any questions?
No, thank you.
Thank you.
Healy, as commissioner, no doubt that as chairman of the chairperson of the commission, you guys have been pretty busy, and it's noted, and we do appreciate you coming before the council and the public and giving us that update.
Thank you very much.
So we got two actors in the council now.
Yep.
They're sitting next to me.
All right, thank you. Presentation by Beautification Commission. Angel, when you get back, please introduce yourself.
We know who you are, but they may not.
Lights.
So we had about 35 volunteers.
Lights, action.
Difficult because sometimes we couldn't even have a whole forum because the
commissioner from there. And for this year, we tried to recreate the beautification day, and I even posted it on the magazine. But when we met with the commissioner, we didn't have that, like, we weren't able to do it again. We had the volunteers and the sponsor was there again to do it, but they said that it was too quick, we couldn't do it that quick. So there wasn't no, like, we weren't able to really, like, push it as much as we did last year. I didn't have the full support. And so, yeah, like, that's when we lost another commissioner. And actually, we only have, out of the original committee, it's just me and another person now. And, like, I'm not aware who was appointed next. And I guess, it is my responsibility to know. But right now, we're trying to create a new committee and seeing how we can move forward with this.
Okay, you're done?
Yes.
No. What's it?
I just want to ask a question.
Yeah.
Would you mind telling us which commissioners are still active and which are not?
Danny Bachat, Francina.
She's active?
She is active.
Okay, you're, how many are in the actively involved in the commission right now? You and?
Francina. Cristina moved out of the city. Armando Real, he was, like, very involved at first. And he really wanted to push, then he just kind of stopped going. I thought it was of health because I asked him and he said health. Then I went back a few months later because he hadn't been attend one. And for other reasons, so that's when we sent him, like, a resign letter.
Okay, so it's noted here that he's resigned.
Yeah, and Diana Cortez, she has an injury and she's unavailable to continue to be part of the committee.
So you need three other appointments?
Yes.
So we can put that as a future agenda item for those council members that are involved with these three persons to appoint three new members. Okay.
Which would be you?
No, as a matter of fact, if I recall correctly, Francina Gonzalez is my appointment.
Okay, she's okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's me. Christina was my
appointment. And Armando Real is my appointment. And Ms. Cortez is.
So we can put that in a note for our future agenda item to get appointments for those. Okay. Thank you, Angel.
Thank you, Angel.
Thank you, Angel.
All right. Presentation by Public Works staff regarding code enforcement, example, business license, trash collection, and other code enforcement matters. Oh, so it's you. You're the lucky one.
Mayor, council members, my name is Ralph Morales. I'm the building and code enforcement manager under the Public Works Department. The following report is the status report regarding the duties and progress of the code enforcement division, as well as a progress report for the months of January through May. Code enforcement division currently consists of two full-time code enforcement officers. And each violation that is investigated takes a period of approximately 20 to 60 minutes, depending on the violation and type of investigation that is being conducted. The following areas that code enforcement responsibility consists of: weed and trash abatement, illegal dumping, graffiti abatement, vehicle abatement, illegal sales of vehicles, yard sales violation, illegal construction, illegal garage enclosure, visit businesses for current business license, illegal sidewalk sales, downtown trash containers, parking vehicles for sale on city street, washing vehicles on the street, illegal posting, illegal auto repair shop in residential areas, illegal business signs, also closing and barricading Belcher Street at the high school and monitoring mobile vendors during the lunch hour, assist the county health staff in enforcing health and safety issues within the city of Calexico, as well as respond to emergency calls from fire and police regarding property code violations and structure damage. These are just a couple. There are other responsibilities that code enforcement does. For each violation, a file is set up along with an activity report. A letter is prepared and mailed to the property owner. This letter identifies the violation and provides a time frame to respond or correct the problem. If no action is taken or response is provided by the property owner within the allocated time, then an administrative citation is issued in person or via certified mail. All this is documented in the case file. Scheduled inspections are also conducted to assure that all violations have been removed and taken care of accordingly. Once a violation is corrected, then the case and the case file is closed. The status report for 2012, the following is a breakdown on the activity of code enforcement. Through January through May, complaints received and investigated. In January, there were 61, 45 in February, 65 in March, 83 in April, and 124 in May. Then there were 40 notices of violation for lack of building permits, and that was in the 5 months. Notices regarding weed and trash, there were 37. Notices of abandoned vehicles, there were 4. There were 51 citations issued within those 5 months. Stop work issued were 3, fire inspections 2, and emergency inspections after working hours, there were 2. During the 5 months of the 2012 calendar year, code enforcement has and is continuing to concentrate most of its time in assisting the finance department with the delinquent business license. A total number of 256 businesses, has been visited to date. There has been 88 letters that have been prepared and mailed out to businesses that have residential addresses. 123 letters prepared and mailed out to businesses who have their business out of town. Letters have also been mailed to both Las Palmas and Remate swap meets, as well as code enforcement visiting the swap meets and for current business license. During the 5 months, as I brought out earlier, there has been 51 citations issued. The majority of those have been from businesses that have not paid their business license or have not come forward. So within those 5 months, $6,625 in citations have been collected by court enforcement. Recently, in May, we were able to acquire an additional help in code enforcement. This has come from another department, the engineering department. With his assistance, we have been able to conduct inspections in other areas as well. To date, 39 portable basketball hoops were found to be illegal on the curbs and sidewalks. These owners were provided with notice of violation and requested that their portable hoops be relocated into their property. An additional 32 residential structures have been identified to be vacated and or abandoned. And so measures are being taken to send letters to the owners or banks so that they can secure those properties. There has been 2 structures that are in dilapidated condition and needed to be secured immediately. So staff has currently been working, because we haven't been able to find the owners, their absentee owners. Staff is now working with the city attorney in taking steps to legally have the property secured for health and safety reasons. Code enforcement has also identified to date 16 residential lots needing cleanup. Now, on the listing for the residential structures that have been vacated, as well as the residential lots that need cleanup, the list has not completed. It is still ongoing, so there will probably be more. Code enforcement has been working with the trash problem downtown, enforcing the cleanup of trash containers. One of the steps taken has been in sending letters to 87 businesses who do not have either trash or recyclable or both containers, informing them that they need to acquire them as per the section in the municipal code of section 8.39.060 and 8.36.020. We have been successful. Many of the businesses are coming forward and getting those containers. With the above day-to-day duties, code enforcement is also required to work beyond the regular 7:30 to 5:30 workday. When called by the fire and police department to secure a fire damage structure or investigate a residential structure that may have been illegal or health or safety issues, code enforcement responded not just in the middle of the night, but even on weekends, so it could be said that code enforcement is on a 24/7 schedule. In conclusion, code enforcement is a continuous effort, as well as an ongoing effort to assure that all residents, community, and businesses abide by the municipal code and to keep it safe and clean as possible. Any questions?
In the process of issuing citations, there's also a hearing process.
Yes, there is.
Last council meeting, you said that they were going to have a hearing May 29th.
Yes.
Was there one held?
There was one held. We had to, that meeting was to be held in the afternoon. Unfortunately, the hearing officer was not able to make it in the afternoon. So we rescheduled for those that could in the morning. And out of three, one was able to attend. The other two need to be rescheduled at a later date.
And it's for both building permits or traffic violations?
This is for code violations.
Code violations. Yes. I meant code violations, mm-hmm. Yes. All right. Anything else, council members?
Yeah, I have questions. Item number 25 on your responsibilities then talks about notices of violations and administrative citations that are issued. Out of the three enforcement officers that we have, of those three, are all three issuing citations? Are they qualified?
They're certified.
Legally qualified to do that? So
yes.
We have three officers that are out there actually being able to write tickets.
Yes.
Okay, and then I'm not sure if you talked about when you issue out then your letters via certified mail and make contact with the violators, if there is no response to that, what exact steps are you taking for follow-up and how often?
If we contact a person has a code violation and they have failed to abide by correcting the issue, then a citation is provided to them. They are given approximately 2 weeks to take care of the citation. If they don't, then in the citation is written that they will receive a second citation if they fail to come forward. Usually if they come in, we have had violators that had come in and informed us that they cannot pay the citation on that time. We will work with them and give them a little more time to come in. We understand the economy is hard, and so $150 is still kind of difficult. They still have to pay the citation. We will work with them as far as if they need an extra week to come in, we will work with them on that.
I was asking more towards the corrective action of the actual.
On the policy. Correction action, we can give as much as 30 days. And again, it depends what the situation is. The basketball hoops, you know, they're given 24, 48 hours to remove those hoops and put it inside their property. If it's a weed abatement, then many times they do need the 30 days to be able to find somebody, depending on the size of the property that they have and the cleanup, then we can give them up to 30 days to do the cleanup.
Okay, just a few more. Okay. I remember a couple, almost 2 years ago, that we were talking about this also. We talked about being proactive, mm-hmm. because your list in your report talks more about actual complaints being received and how the activity is going on for complaints that are being received, but are we also proactive? For example, I know that in downtown we have on Second Street a fence that's enclosing, let's see, I think it might be, I think it's Heber Avenue and Second. I believe it's across the street from where the Western Auto mm-hmm. Repair Shop used to be. And that fence is falling down, it's a hazard. So that I think about that when I'm asking yes. you that question.
We have mm-hmm.
the Womack.
We have contacted the real estate people. We have asked them to clean the property and also to repair that chain link fence.
Okay, so that type of activity is not in this report?
That type of activity, some of the activities are not here, yes.
Okay, and then another curious question is, in January you had 61 complaints received and investigated, and it jumps over then to double that amount in the month of May. Is that, I think that's what you were saying, it's because of business licenses that we're not paying?
Yes. Yes, a lot of them in May, we were more active in going out with the businesses. It became easier for the code enforcement officer to go back and revisit some of those businesses.
And the last question that I just wrote a note here was about commercial cleanup again. Is we took a tour just recently, Councilman Castro and I, together with Ms. Racuña, and we took a good look at a lot of different issues that were in the downtown area and in the city of Calexico in general. So we have a lot of issues with commercial buildings who have closed, and now they have the weed issues and the graffiti, and it's all in that one location. So I think I would appreciate probably knowing a little bit more about that too, because that is a really big problem.
Okay.
Okay, I'm done.
So, Mr. Morales, we go out, we enforce, there's violation. We, correct me, let me get this straight, we send a letter. And if there's no response, correction, then there's a citation. And then there's a second citation. And if they're not responding, what happens after that?
Then there is, the citations go from 150 to 300, and from 300 to 450. And then from there, we would take some type of legal action to have them corrected. The majority of the time, people by the first citation, they will call us up and take care of it. We do have, you know, going back into the identifying the abandoned and vacated properties, we do have, I think right now, three properties that we have sent letters to, and one of them being one of the properties that was in question, and there was a concern on that. Unfortunately, we have not been able to find the owners. So in situations like that, we do our follow-up by sending the proper letters and the citations, even though they come back. Then at that point, then this is when we work with legal to help us to legally be able to secure the property. And because legally, we can't just go in there and secure a property without due process or due notice to the property owner, even though we are not able to locate them. There has to be a process, and that's what we're doing right now. Once that is done, then we can legally go in there, do what we have to do. The cost for that, and it would come to the council to get approval, but the cost for any abatement, closing of a abandoned house, then that would have to be a cost from the city, and then from there's a lien that's put on the property within the tax roll.
And I heard you right, you said that after usually the majority of violators respond and goodwill.
Yeah, usually, well, yeah. Yeah, no, nobody wants to pay $150, so, and then they...
So you'd say that that citation has teeth?
It has very good teeth on it.
And then from the second or third, is there a
timeline? Yeah, we usually give them probably about 2 or 3 weeks for them to come in and pay the citation. It's very rare that I can remember that any citation has gone beyond the second issuance. Yeah.
Here's your opportunity. Is there an area that you would like to articulate where we might be able to improve in the system?
Well, one of the things that we basically need, because right now all these steps that we do is done manually. Our files are done manually. Our reports are done manually. Many times it becomes very difficult when we go out there and we identify a property that has a code violation. 6 months down the line, they may take care of it. 6 months down the line, or a year down the line, then we go back, and if it's a different code enforcement officer, then they may forget or just not remember what had happened prior. If we would have the proper programs, then not only would that become a reminder where we could plug in the address, it would tell us a history of how many violations that property has had, but it also would help us to issue the notice of violation. It would help us print out the citations and even provide letters that are needed, and it could all be done automatically, where staff wouldn't have to come back to the office, sit down, pull a file out, and then have to go one by one and spend more time in the office than is needed.
Thank you.
Mr. Mayor, I have one question. You spoke on abandoned buildings, specifically this house on the 400 block of Encinas. You know which house I'm talking about?
Yes, exactly. That's one of the ones that we're working on. Okay. That has the property owner, we've been working on it for a while now, and we have been unable to locate the property owner. And that's one of the ones that we are getting assistance from the city attorney office to find out what the next process is to be able to legally go in and secure that property.
And I'm sure neighbors on both sides aren't very happy with the graffiti and the broken windows.
Yeah.
Would houses gone under foreclosure, would we look at the banks to see, is that the process?
Yes. Yes, that's one of the things. And usually houses that are abandoned, for the most part, they're picked up by the banks. So we need to do a little bit of investigation, find out who the bank is if they don't post it.
Right.
So
the bank is liable for cleaning it up?
Bank is liable to clean it up. We have a case in point would be the structure right there in the corner of Rockwood, and I think it's Temple. It's a two-story house that burned down.
Yes.
And we were working with the bank and...
Ninth and Rockwood,
yes. So on that one, we were working with the bank and finally somebody went in there and they torched it. And so we finally got the bank to go in there and secure it, putting a fence around it so nobody would go in.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes, question. I don't know if you noticed, but Pierce and Sheridan, there is a house on back of the, I think it's Rodriguez Park. Mm-hmm. There is, right there in the corner, there is a house with very deteriorated shade. So I would like to pay attention to go up there and talk to these persons, mm-hmm. and trying to look for, I know there. I don't know if it's still there, the program to, what's the name of the program?
Oh, yeah.
It's
the housing program?
Yes, rehab program. And because you mentioned some buildings are abandoned, but this house is very, the shade mm-hmm. is very deteriorated.
That's on the corner of Pierce and?
Yes, right there in, Pierce and Sheridan.
Sheridan.
Yeah, it's behind the baseball field. I believe it's Rodriguez Field, right? Yes, it is. And also question, I'm not sure, but Is there a possibility, is there a grant or some fund that we can use for to paint the second and, I believe, second and third in the area of the downtown, the alleys? I mean, it should be a great idea to paint the whole alley from, I believe, from Heber to Pauline Avenue. I mean,
is that private property?
Well, it is, but remember, we need to look for beautification in the downtown, and we can talk to the owner, so we can look for some funds, and we can do that. So, I mean, it's a great idea to paint the alleys too. Mm-hmm. So it's just an idea,
okay.
So we can work on that. Thank you. That's it.
Mr. Morales, I'm going to repeat one more time. We took a four-hour cruise, Mr. Castro and I, last week, and I'm sorry, 2 weeks ago. And our intention was to look out, take a look at all the different parks and the conditions of the parks, but we were more taken aback by the situation with the tumbleweeds and the deteriorated properties and abandoned properties. That was probably a bigger concern after that review, that summary, trying to summarize everything that's going on. And I know that I've received quite a bit of complaints about that type of property and the conditions of our, for example, Imperial Avenue.
Mm-hmm.
So hopefully now that you have three members on your team, we can start focusing on that, because the complaints are pretty consistent. Okay. So I really appreciate that.
Okay.
Is one of the houses that you mentioned that's been abandoned on Washington Street?
There's a house on Washington that was secured. I have not gone back to since the last time that they secured it. So I went and I checked the alley.
They did secure it?
They did secure it at that time. Now, that was what the last time I saw was must have been about 4-6 months ago. And at that time, it was secured.
Okay, one of the things that that I've been asking for is, and you mentioned it in the, it's listed as such, in the title of the presentation regarding trash collection.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you were talking commercial?
I was talking commercial, yes.
Because I'm still waiting for a report for the residentials. Okay. There's been some cone enforcement on residents. And it's been, to the report that I have, is somewhat inconsistent, and this is why hopefully at the next, not the next council meeting, I won't be here. But hopefully at the first beginning of July, you can have a presentation regarding that, residential. Now, you mentioned something right now that caught my attention, and because it is something that, if I'm not mistaken, the couple that is here, I have not met them. But on the corner of Blair and Third,
mm-hmm.
there's they have had a recurring situation where they, as owners, and again, I have not met with them, but they have owners. Something I was informed that they have owners are having a recurring problem with graffiti, and they have painted it over. Then a few months go by, and they do graffiti again. City goes in and gives them a code violation. Then they come back and gives them another code violation. I understand the purpose of code enforcement is to do what they have to do, and I'm going to say even right on what Mr. Castro said a moment ago about beautification, aesthetics, whatever you want to call it, for the city of Calexico. But this is something that it's completely out of their control. It's not like something from the structure is hanging down ready to hurt somebody. There has to be some form of a mitigation in order for them not to be receiving recurring code violations when it comes to graffiti. I would really like to maybe as well with the other one, expand on the procedures in regards to those things like that where the owner of the property, the owner of the structure has no control and still receiving violations instead of maybe a warning. And then you have situations where the owners may not be able to, one, afford not only the paying of the fine, but mitigate the situation. So then what happens next? Anyway, they're here to, I guess, speak about it in a few minutes.
Would that be considered a high traffic graffiti area?
Well, it's definitely a very, as I say, about location, location, location.
Right, but shouldn't there also be a designation? I know that other cities have certain designations for certain parts of the cities that are either high crime or high, in this case, high graffiti. I think I did mention it to you one time, didn't I, Chief, about the designation of...
And how does that help?
Well, I can't recall. It's been about a couple of months. I know that I talked to you about something like that. I got out of Western City and County Magazine, sponsored by the League of California Cities, and there was an area that had a high gang problem. Usually where there's graffiti, there's gangs. Usually where there's gangs, there's crime. Okay. So, but I was reading there somewhere that there was a designation that that area was designed by the city or designated by the city, and I guess funds or certain resources were more readily available to them.
Okay.
Right. And I can't recall for the life of me what it was called, but I know there was a designation. Much like you have an enterprise zone, or you have a high crime zone, et cetera, et cetera, so the city may be able to offset some resources for that.
Okay. Well, again, maybe at the first meeting in July, trash code enforcement on trash cans for residential. And I don't know, maybe some language on recurring violations of something like this.
Where the owners are, I think what you're trying to say is that these owners appear to be cooperating in good faith, and it's not, they're not purposely
correct
ignoring it.
Yes.
It just continues to occur. It's it's hard to keep up.
And it just, okay. Mr. and Mrs. Wong, Mr. Jimmy and Bonnie Wong, owns Jimmy's Market for many years. Nice to see you guys.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Morales. All right. Announcement, public comments. And these presentations, city manager, maybe not in the public, not in the presentation section. Since there's going to be expecting some dialogue back and forth, and presentations is just for the one side to give their what they're offering, because we're going to go through some dialogue for sure, so we can put it maybe under an informational item. All right. Public comments are welcome. Speakers will be limited to 3 minutes. Please complete a speaker form prior to the start of the meeting. If the item you wish to comment on is a closed session item, please comment now. If the item you wish to comment on is on the public portion of the agenda, we will take your comment when we get to the item on the agenda. First is Ms. Bonnie Wong. Where are you going, Willie?
Good evening. I'm Bonnie Wong. I am the owner of the property at 600 3rd Street, the corner of 3rd and Blair. I wrote this letter and sent out copies to five city councilmen and Mr. Rodriguez. I never received a report comment from them acknowledging that they had received my letter. I'll start reading it from the beginning. I received a letter from Officer Quinn on September 2009. He stated he received complaints about graffiti on the vacant building I owned. I did correct the problem. I painted over the graffiti several times throughout the year. I have bills and receipts showing I bought paint, brushes, and supplies. In May 210. I received a second letter with pictures from Officer Quinn. He is not aware that I had painted over the building, and never at any times in his letter did he instruct me to notify him of the corrections. Yes, I painted over the lower part of the building, which was the worst, as the top of the building seemed minimal. Please read my comments at the end of the letter. When I painted over the graffiti, within 2 or 3 weeks, it was marked with graffiti again. On October 10, he wrote up a violation, and I was fined $150. He told my husband he could not tear up the citation for us to appeal our case. I filed an appeal in November 2010. There was no city referee at this time and was told my appeal would put in the file. On January 2011, Mike Davis was hired. About March 2011, I went to check and asked for an appointment to be heard. I was told my appeal application was lost. When I received the second letter from Officer Quinn, I would take care of the graffiti, but I needed more time as my handyman was on vacation. Nevertheless, Officer Quinn cited us. I do check on the building all the time. I'm trying to get this building rented. Graffiti is everywhere. Very hard to catch the taggers. I have been to the city hall many times to ask about my appeal. I did file a second appeal and spoke with Mr. Ralph Morales on August 24, 2011. He told me on September 7th to speak with Officer Quinn. On September 7th, 2011, Wednesday, 2 p.m., I was told there was no city referee. Officer Quinn knew nothing of my appeal. He would look up on his computer and called me back. I told Officer Quinn I had complied and painted over the graffiti on the building. He commented, only the bottom part was painted. Yes, this was true. The worst part was on the bottom. We did not paint the top part of the building because our handyman is only a handyman. He's not a professional. We worry that they might fall from the higher ceiling part of the building to injure themselves, and they are just working for minimum wage, so we do not want him to paint the upper part of the building, only the lower part where the graffiti was the worst. I do not want to forfeit my money of $150. I want the city to know that I am still waiting for an appointment to have my appeal heard. I commented to Officer Quinn. He did not follow through on my case. He told me he has followed through on my case, so he knows I have painted over the graffiti many times. Therefore, I am puzzled as to why Officer Quinn wrote up a citation on us. We have painted many times over the graffiti. I was told a city referee was recently hired. I am wondering when I can be scheduled to have my case heard. As of Monday, September 19, 2011, I have not heard from Officer Quinn. I sent this letter to 5 city councilmen and Oscar Rodriguez. I have a follow-up on April 23, 2012. I still have not had any results. On November 1, 2011, Mr. Morales did call me. He told me I would have a hearing, an appeal heard within 30 days. I waited and waited. March 6, I called Mr. Morales at 3 p.m. He was busy at a meeting and said he would call me back. On March 7, 5 p.m., I called and Mr. Morales was out making an inspection. On March 8, Mr. Morales said he did not forget me. The city has hired a referee. Today is, this was April 23. But I would expect After a reasonable passing of time, I would get a hearing or my fee and fine returned. I do not want the city of Calexico to think I am forfeiting this money. That's all.
Thank you, Ms. Wong. I don't know which of the council members did receive your letter. I did receive it through Ms. Torres, Loli Torres. Loli?
Oh, Loli Torres.
Yes. She showed me the letter. Uh-huh. I had an opportunity to go by your building and look at it from every angle. And obviously, it's very, again, one of the locations where it could easily display the graffiti from every angle.
I have the building rented now, so.
Yes, you do, and I see that you painted it over. It's cleaned up, and the building looks very nice. But I could see that from that angle, from that location, that it would be a very attractive place to put something there. Yes, the it's unfortunate that you have not been given the appointment for the hearing. Tonight I will be making an appointment for a hearing officer, and hopefully Mr. Morales will put you on the top of the list before he hears one other case. I'm sure he has a backlog of hearings to conduct, but I believe you're a patient since 2010.
Well, yes. I know the city has very important matters and business to take care of, and this is not utmost on their priority list. I know that.
Ms. Wong, I can assure you, as a citizen of the city of Calexico, you are a priority and very important.
Thank you, Mayor Romero.
Thank you. So, Ralph, if you could be exchange information about how to schedule these appointment in the near future.
Thank you.
Okay, next. Honorable Supervisor District 1, John Renison.
I like the way you say that. You know, we go back and forth with honorable all the time, don't we, Dave?
Honorable Mayor, City Council, honorable. From time to time, I'll be here, but enfadarlos un poco.
Thank you.
To talk a little bit about what the county is doing and what the city is doing. We had a very exciting meeting a couple of weeks ago. You were there in attendance at the East Port of Entry. I think we're getting very close to establishing a bus shuttle service from there to Calexico. I won't go into all the details, but U.S. Customs has said that they're very, very receptive to a bus service, private bus service, not public, because the ICTC wouldn't have the resources right now to do that. Mr. Romero, I don't want to bore you, but if the other council members are unaware, basically the bus would come in to the port of entry at the East Port, pick up at the very door, and bring people to Calexico a couple of stops, make a round robin. So it would be basically a circular route, and I think that's very doable within the next month or two, and we're working on it. And the other thing, the complimentary thing on the other side of the border would be, for those of you familiar with just south of the bridge coming from Mexicali, there's a cutaway in the Mexican side where a bus from Mexico could actually come up and leave people, pedestrians, and they'd only have to walk the distance less than what the tunnel is downtown. So there's some potential there. Even if we don't get the Mexican side to cooperate, that's going to be in their lap, but certainly we're going to pitch it to them, and hopefully that'll work. The other item, Congresswoman Loretta Sanchez, as you know, is a ranking member on the Homeland Security Committee. The Border Ad Hoc Committee had a meeting a couple of weeks ago. Mr. Romero, you were there. And it was decided that we would be writing a letter, a very strong letter, to the Homeland Security Secretary regarding our issues here at the Calexico Port of Entry, which, you know, we sound like a broken record. And at this point, we've exhausted all local patience with residents and with everybody else. And as you know, hour and a half, 2 hour waits, I don't have to get into that. We know it's obvious, it's in our face every day. And this community not only lives off of Mexicali, but you know, we know we're tight at the hip and we need to do something about it. So hopefully after this election is over and another couple of weeks, we'll be hopefully going to Washington to meet with the Homeland Security Secretary. I can't promise that, but we're working on it in conjunction with the City of Calexico to do that, and certainly county and city officials will be welcome to join us on that trip to directly with the Homeland Security Secretary. Tomorrow morning at 9:45, there'll be a hearing at the Board of Supervisors regarding public health permits, food service establishments, in other words, your licenses to do business, and also for nonprofits and for profits. There's some items there that raise some red flags, fee increases. Some of them are fee decreases. It's really surprising that there's been very little protest or people that are concerned. There's been meetings that were scheduled over the last couple of months where public health had two people, three people, four people, five people, and it's really surprising that there's been such little participation. You're talking about fees for pools, fees for water systems, and the list goes on. Like, there's 75 different fees. Like I say, some of the fees have gone down, the proposed fees, so this will be at 9:45 tomorrow, so if you're not there, you'll probably read about it Wednesday morning. But I intend to certainly oppose any increases in fees to the mom-and-pop grocery stores and small restaurants. Those fees are proposed to go up 75%. In some cases, and I just can't see in this economy doing that. You know, these programs have to pay for themselves. As you know, we have to pay the inspectors and have to pay for the time. But, you know, one thing is increasing 75%, and another thing is increasing something that's more palatable. So that's kind of what's on our radar. Solar projects continue to swamp us. We have over 26 applications in the whole county. One of the ones that would hit close to home would be the one just east of Calexico, or west of Calexico 98. Just to give you an idea, that one solar project, yes, Mr. Romero, one more minute, that solar project will contribute $500,000 to the Calexico Unified School District, another $200,000 or $300,000 to the Heffernan Memorial Board. So those projects will be bringing money into the county, as well as benefit fees that will be divided up into outlying areas that need a lot of infrastructure. And really, that's it, unless somebody has any questions. But we continue to work hard on this stuff, and I know you guys are also working on the casino tomorrow in Manzanita, and we'll continue to work on that as well.
Thank you, Supervisor Renison. Okay, next speaker, Carmen Estrada, Calexico Parents Athletic League.
Buenas noches, soy Carmen Estrada, directora atlética del programa Calexico Parents Athletic League. Esta vez estoy aquí con ustedes para invitarlos el sábado. Vamos a tener un torneo de soccer de 65 equipos. Va a ser San Diego, todo el Valle Imperial y Yuma. Y pues también vamos a tener una llegada de un helicóptero. El señor Romero nos los consiguió. Es un sueño más para este programa, para los niños de Calexico, para el Central League. Están cordialmente invitados, porque acuérdense que el futuro de todo el Valle Imperial y de nosotros son los niños. Y la unión hace la fuerza. Y creo que ya estamos unidos. Y espero que sigamos así, porque así vamos a triunfar todos. Gracias.
Gracias, Carmen Estrada. Y pues también gracias, Nick Servín, por being able to put this together. ¿El evento a qué horas, Carmen? Y pues ya como le informé, desafortunadamente voy a estar fuera de la ciudad y éxito en su evento.
Son 1,200 niños los que van a estar en diferentes escuelas. Es ALSA, High School, Quinta y Andrade, Daniel Gutiérrez y Casitas. Esto es un éxito, es algo bien bonito y ojalá estén todos con nosotros.
Felicidades. Gracias. Okay, general comments by council members. Mr. Moreno.
Yes, I got just a couple. I just want to thank the city staff and the Chamber of Commerce and the entertainment that was had by the Mariachi Festival we had a couple weeks ago. We haven't met since then. It was good to see a lot of people out there. Not as many as we expected, but nonetheless, we need to continue with these community festivities whenever we can. It's always good to see families out there enjoying themselves. Big thanks to the Chamber and the city staff. Peter Castro, I guess, was out there, and so were the police officers. And, I guess most of our city council was out there, too. Also, I just had a concern about Memorial Day. I didn't see any flags downtown. Was there a reason why we didn't have any flags downtown on Memorial Day? Usually on every legal holiday, we have the flags downtown. Nick? I had several concerned citizens ask me that.
Yeah, I was trying to arrange to have the flags
put up by a volunteer group, and I thought they were taken care of. Apparently, they weren't. Sorry about that.
So hopefully for the 4th of July, we will have them up.
Yes.
Okay.
I'll put them up myself.
Okay. I'll help you. Finally, congratulations to the grads that are going to be graduating this week throughout the schools. And that's all I have, Mr. Mayor. I know we've got a long agenda.
Yes. Thank you, Mr. Moreno. Mr. Castro.
Yes, I would like to congratulate the school district board members and also the administration of this district, school district, because they inaugurate Jefferson School. That's benefit a student of this city, so that's something that I concern. Anything related to education, I concern, and again, thank you for your participation, school district board members, and also administration. That's it.
Thank you, Mr. Castro. Mr. Hodge?
Along with Mayor Pro Tem Hurtado, I attended the California-Mexico Border Relations Council here in these chambers. And of course, there were some very, very good reports from various agencies, organizations, but the New River. And I'm proud to say a lot of hard work has been put in this by the leadership of Miguel Figueroa and the New River Committee. And so we have the strategic plan, ladies and gentlemen. And California-Mexico Borders Relations, with all open arms, embraced it and accepts it. So that was very good news. We're moving forward. Try to make this quick. Street sweepers. Are we going to repair, or when are we going to replace the second street sweeper? Is it dormant? Is it sitting there? Or do we have two operating, cleaning the wonderful streets of Calexico?
One of my workers got injured trying to repair one of the sweepers.
Sorry to hear.
Yeah. I'll try to find out tomorrow what the status is.
But we have a plan and we're executing it on this?
And we have another one on order from ICTC funds.
So we're working on it?
We're working on it.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Other issue. It's been a long time since I brought it up when I first came in here. Mrs. Guerrero on Human Resources. What's the status on time clocks? I know we had wrestled with that, or I inquired, and it's been so long. Do we have a set policy for time clocks?
We have a draft policy that was provided to administration for their review.
We have a policy.
We have a draft policy that has not been adopted. It's just the draft policy that was put together for review, presented to administration, and we're just awaiting to review it and move forward.
I'll try to make this simple. When it first came in, I had seen some departments or areas with time clocks. Were they being used, or were they just up there for?
No, the time clocks are actually being used by departments. However, we don't have a policy that outlines the usage. When you have a policy, it actually goes into stating the time that an employee may clock in. For example, if they clock in 10 minutes before 8 o'clock, then it's counted as being on time. If they clock in 10 minutes after 8 o'clock, they're considered to be late. Those are the types of items that need to be drafted in the policy. So we've got some draft language. However, it does need to be circulated to the departments and to administration. And once we agree on that, it's something that also possibly, I believe, needs to be shared with the bargaining groups, because it has to do with employees' hours and wages.
What do you see as the next couple of steps in a timeline?
In a timeline, I would have to defer to the city manager on that.
Well, we can certainly take a look at the policy. I will say that there is an administrative policy on who punches in, who has to punch in. I know that was circulated in reference to the people who have to punch in. As far as a more detailed policy, we'll have to look into it. But there is an administrative policy on who punches in and who doesn't. And I will say that the employees are pretty good about punching in.
We're going to move forward on this one. We have a plan. We're going to execute it.
We can look at a draft plan, whatever that is, but again, there is an administrative policy. If you're asking if there's an administrative policy, who punches in, who doesn't, there is. It can always be more detailed. You want to have some flexibility, so we'll look at providing another policy. The policy is really pretty simple. If you have to punch in at 8 o'clock, you have to punch in at 8 o'clock. If you're after 8 o'clock, you're late. It's a pretty simple policy. So you start getting into setting policies in writing that says it gives you 10 minutes, then all of a sudden you get people punching in at 8:05 because you can be late up to 9 minutes. Again, we'll look at the policy, but the policy is pretty simple. You start your work day at 8 o'clock, you have to be there by 8 o'clock. But if you're looking for actual something in writing, we can certainly look to do something in writing.
Thank you. That's all, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Mr. Hunch. Mayor Pro Tem Hurtado.
As I was mentioning earlier, Councilman Castro and I, we met to start this and believe in helping us to do the mowing. So that the day that many of our parks just need, we took a good look at Mr. Acuña to get that hard work.
3 minutes, John. Meeting during your successful event in that manner to Peter Castro for his safety service to be ready appears that helped the chamber make it a Rotarians. They held a meeting at San Diego State based on what they think, say, or do. And the first one is entry. Efforts continue to promote funding through another step. Thank you, and more importantly, the students and the people. Please take the time to go and vote. Good luck to the
Mr. Mayor.
Yes.
Pulled. Mayor Pro Tem Hurtado can remain at the day. It's up to you. Motion for a consent agenda. She gets to stay here. So it
but
just depends
no,
on if there
there's going to be an item that's going to be removed.
Oh, if it's going to be removed, yes. Then yes.
Okay. So in that regard, we will pull item 7. Okay. Any other items to be pulled? No? No? All right, I'll pull number 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. No, just kidding. Pull number 8, just a correction there, and number 13. Okay, so in item number 7, a motion for its approval without her, by her reclusing herself.
Then it doesn't, if there's no question.
Oh, wait, I'm sorry. Consent calendar.
Okay.
Is there a motion to approve 1 through 6, 9 through 12, and 14?
So moved.
Second.
Is there a tiebreaker here? Okay. Motion by Mr. Moreno, second by Mayor Pro Tem Hurtado. Please vote. Okay, good. Thank you. Real quick, on item number 7, since Mayor Pro Tem had to recluse herself, I'll just go ahead and motion for its approval.
Second.
And all those in favor, please display your vote. Okay, so it goes 4-0 with Mayor Pro Tem reclusing on this item. Number 8, acknowledge a receipt of recreation minutes. It's only a correction. The attendance report names 3 present with 1 absent. There are 4 or 5 members, yet the missing 4th name was not included as attending. So if you can just correct that record, Luli, if you can inform the Recreation Commission. And that name that is missing there from being that being present is Rick Ortega. I'll go ahead and motion for approval of this item. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Motion by yours truly, second by Mr. Hodge. Vote, please. Vote 4-0 with Mayor Pro Tem not present at this time. And number 13, the only reason I pulled it is because of the formula here. I really would prefer that the city manager explain this issue.
13 being on the New River?
13, oh, excuse me, wrong one. Yes, why, I had an explanation on the New River, why a 6-month and not a 12-month agreement?
The request was actually made by the director of the New River Committee, so I would defer to him to find out why that was, but we had no problem with the 6-month, and Miguel is here if he wants to respond to that. It was their request.
Please, Miguel.
Mayor, members of the City Council, City Manager, City Attorney, the purpose of coming up with a 6-month contract is because based on what happened a couple of weeks ago with the California-Mexico Border Relations Council approving the plan, what's critical right now is the assistance that we can provide to the city in this span of time. We consider this to be very important that I assist the project manager, who is Nick Servin, because within these 6 months, a report needs to be provided to not only Caltrans, but also the state's resources agency. So we believe that that is where we came up with 6 months, because based on the timeline that we have for the project, it was pertinent to stick and make our goals, which is around that time. That is why.
Okay, because I was wondering why not
more
time,
right?
Which obviously would have given you consideration for additional funding.
Yeah, and the city legal counsel brought this issue up too, and the circumstances allow us within the language in the contract, if needed, to extend it.
Okay, all right, very good.
Okay,
that's
thank you.
Thank you. Motion to approve.
Second.
Motion by yours truly, second by Mr. Moreno. Please vote. And okay, there you go. All right, 5-0. Thank you. City Attorney, I messed up. It was also item number 6 that I wanted to pull that I wanted the city manager to explain. Can we still comment on it?
If council agrees, sure.
Council?
Sure.
Okay, it's agreed. It's already been approved, but if you can explain, city manager, on how, what these numbers represent. I want to make sure that there's no misunderstanding that this is a proposed budget issue.
No, and in fact, we wish we could come to you and recommend a $23 million general fund in which we had the money. But what this actually is a requirement every year that we establish the appropriations limit for the city. And this all started back in 1979 with the issue of Article 13 of the state constitution, which limited the amount of revenue that could be spent by entities of government based on specific revenue sources that they would get that would extract the cost of the revenue, the cost from the revenue, but would not allow the city to spend money up and beyond that limit. So without getting into a lot of detail, basically what it does, it takes the proceeds of taxes, which includes all taxes levied by the city, and any revenue from regulatory licenses, user charges, user fees, to the extent that the proceeds exceed the cost of providing the service, regulation, or discretionary subventions of interest in investment of proceeds of taxes. So the appropriation limit applies to all taxes levied by the city, with some exceptions having to do with redevelopment enterprise and special assessment districts. So basically it takes the general fund money and says you are allowed to spend so much of that revenue. And every year from the year, the base year of 78-79, you're allowed to increase. And this is for some of you who were born before I was, as Proposition 4, if you remember that in 78-79, when we also went in through Proposition 13 and all of those regulations that we went through on limiting our revenue sources and so on. And so what that does, it basically says in 78-79 base year, you're allowed to increase that level by CPI, consumer price index and population of your growth on your city. So that limit keeps increasing every year. The significance of this is that this year our appropriations limit is scheduled to be $23,500,000, and yet our whole general fund is scheduled to be somewhere between $18 to $19 million for the coming year. So as you can see, the differential is quite a bit. You know, we're talking about, what, $5 million, maybe $6 million. So I think the idea that we wanted to make sure that everybody understood that if the economy would continue to grow, then maybe we'd be up to somewhere in the $20 million. But unfortunately, the economy has actually shrank. And so we're having to cut. We're having to make these tough decisions on cutting our expenditures because our revenue sources are just not there. And so our revenue sources have actually gone down while the limit has gone up. So in fact, there is quite a gap between what we could spend if we had the money and what we are spending. So I think if there's one message to be sent with this appropriations limit is that we're having to make these tough decisions. Our revenue sources unfortunately have gone down, and therefore we can't spend money we don't have. So I think that's the message that we're trying to bring here tonight, with the appropriations limit being up at over $23 million and our general fund being at around $18
million. Okay, thank you. I think your $18-19 million is a little bit optimistic, and I hope the city is able to secure that. All right, thank you, City Manager Rodriguez. We'll go to business items. Discussion, interaction, or designation of voting delegates and alternates for the League of California Cities Annual Conference, September 5th through the 7th, 2012 in San Diego. I will attend, so I would be one of the designees. Who else will be attending?
I would be attending as well.
Okay, so if it's okay with the consensus of this council to have these three persons as the delegates, will you be attending, Mr. Moreno?
I hadn't planned on it, but if you three want to attend, I think that would be great for you to represent our city.
Well, one is for the delegates, the other for the voting delegate, the other thing is for being able to attend. I think that...
I'm not sure if we have, do we have money in that?
You have plenty of time, yes. And our budgets do allow for it. I would certainly encourage anybody who can attend, because it's not often that we get it in San Diego. So you actually could go back and forth if right. You wanted to. So if you can attend, I would certainly encourage everybody to attend.
I will attend then.
Mr. Castro?
I will attend.
Okay, then all five members of the council will be present.
So we just need to designate the delegate right. And who the alternates are.
Well, there's only one voting delegate. Right. There are some issues where there's two that vote. And unless I am not able to be present for that particular session, then both of you can vote on behalf of the city. All right. Next, mayor, council member appointments.
So you are the delegate and we are the alternates?
Yes. The appointment to Arts Commission by Councilman Moreno.
Yeah, I'd like to appoint Leah Arellano. Her application is there.
Excellent.
She would be a great addition to the Arts Commission.
Great. Appointment to Arts Commission by Councilman Castro.
Yes, I would like to appoint Estelita Castañeda.
Estelita?
Estelita Castañeda.
Okay.
Yes.
So you're going to have a conflict, potential conflict of schedule, or?
It's not in the rules right now. They can serve on multiple commissions if they want, if the council approves. Cool.
So that means if she wants to stay in both commissions, she can stay?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. But, well, at the end of the council, public council meeting, I would like to ask for to open that commission for recreation department.
Oh, okay.
In the for future agenda item.
Okay. All right. Thank you. All right. Appointment of hearing officer by yours truly. I do want to thank former Mayor Castro's appointee, Francisco Sanchez.
Correct, Francisco Sanchez?
Francisco Sanchez, yes.
For his contributions during his tenure as hearing officer. I did receive a call to consider him for retaining him. Unfortunately, I do not have the pleasure of knowing the person and decided to go in a different direction. Obviously, there were some other popular choices, but after some discussion and review, I'll be appointing Carl Moninger. I've already talked to him. He will accept the appointment. He's a former Calexico police officer, former county probation officer, former Department of Health Services investigator, and currently a part-time bailiff with the Sheriff's Department.
He's from Calexico?
He lives here in Calexico.
Oh, class of 75, he was a hell of a pitcher.
He couldn't be a quarterback because he threw right through you. Yeah, I heard. Anyway, he has accepted the invitation for the appointment. Now the question is, who does it report to? City Manager, Nick Servin, who does, Mr. Morales, it reports to you? Okay, well, what is it that, yes?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, he's a hearing officer for both, and that would be under the Director of Public Works, which probably would then tie it into Mr. Ralph Morales.
Okay, we'll let him know. Anyway, thank you, Mr. Manager, for accepting, and thank you, Mr. Sanchez, for contributing. All right, let's go to public hearing.
Mr. Mayor, did we skip number 16, the voluntary separation incentive program?
Which one?
Number 16.
We just handled 16.
Okay, I must have the wrong version of the agenda.
14,
I'm sorry.
That was passed
I printed
under
a version
county.
Of the agenda on Friday that was online, so it's different than the one that I got today. Thanks.
So what do we do?
No, it's fine. You already approved the voluntary separation. It's on the consent on the version that was printed today.
All right. 17, public hearing. Okay. Hold public hearing for proposed fee increase for community center and senior hall rental. Let me see here. First,
basically, if you recall, we brought it to you the last meeting, and we wanted to hold a public hearing, give the public a chance to obviously comment on it. What we're asking for tonight is that you consider raising the fee roughly $50 so that it will, the effects from the CPI, Consumer Price Index, is what we're looking to catch up on, and I believe it's 3 years that we have to catch up on. We're not asking you to actually raise the fee of the rental base amount. We're just asking to catch up on CPI. As you recall, and it's in our report, when the fees were put together, there was a maximum study that was done in July of 2009, and the rate that the council elected at that point to peg the rental fee at was half of what the study suggested. So we are far below what the rental amount should be. And so tonight we're not asking for any major adjustments on the rental fee, but rather just to catch up with CPI.
Okay, thank you. All right, it is now 8:26 p.m. Public hearing is open. All those not in favor of the increase, please come forward. Being that nobody is stepping forward, now we'll go anybody that is in favor of the increase, please come forward. Okay, no one's coming forward. So now I'll take it to council, Mr. Moreno.
Looking at the table that was provided for us, where they have the comparisons, and looking at the comparisons of square footage, we only have two square footage comparisons, actually three square footage comparisons. The Brawley Lions Center at 8,836 square feet. The community center almost 4,000 square feet, and then the senior hall, we'll say 2,400 square feet. Why is the Brawley Lions Center $40 per hour? And you were at Brawley before, Mr. Rodriguez.
I don't claim that.
Okay. With a five-hour limit to come up to $200 for 8,000 square feet. And then we've got ours for half the size, and we're charging almost 2.5 times that limit. Zabrali Lions Center is part of the Lions Club, not part of the city, right?
That's correct.
So it's a it's a nonprofit, not-for-profit club.
And that's difficult to compare it against that. Fortunately, a lot of the rates are very, very low. If we start comparing business licenses, you'll find out that they're very, very low, but they haven't increased them in a long time. So that kind of skews the study when you look at that particular item.
But then I'm looking at the capacity for the Brawley Lions Center for 200 and with twice the square footage, and we have a 320 capacity. There are some discrepancies that are there, and I don't know why. I guess I'm not in favor of raising the fees at this time. It's good for discussion, but that's where I'm headed. So I'm not getting a clear picture as to why we are pretty expensive as is. I don't think it's an accurate comparison with other cities. You've got the El Centro Community Center, which we don't have a square footage, but I know I've been there. It's on the east side. And as I recall, it's either about the same or pretty close to our size of our community center, maybe bigger, but they charge $176 an hour. That's smaller. Is it smaller?
Yeah, it is smaller.
It's been a while since I've been there.
And as you can see, it's $176 and with a limited charge of 6 hours.
And so we charge a $650 fee for the community center for 24 hours or 12 hours. Let's say I'm going to rent it for Saturday. Can I get in there and start setting up?
I believe they have to turn in the keys by the following morning, early the following morning. I don't recall what the timeline is. Does anybody know from staff? I don't recall, but it's early the following morning. Unfortunately, Sandra had to be in Sacramento today.
Right, to occupy, you can occupy it in the morning, right, even though your event is until the evening, to get things ready.
Okay. Women's Improvement, is that city-owned? Or is that also non-for-profit?
Non-profit.
It's a Women's Improvement Club, yes. It's so not city-owned.
It's not city-owned?
No.
So I'm not sure. I don't think I have enough information to make a decision on it today. Senior Hall is half the size, but we're almost charging the same amount. Why is that? Because of the kitchen, or is it? You notice it's 160 capacity, 320 capacity for the community center, and we're charging $150 less. I'd like to look in the square footage and get a price per square feet, much like when we charge fees for certain buildings, for certain housing, what square footage. We charge rent. We're charging rent for the theaters. We did that research last week. It should have been at least $14 a square foot. We're not even charging half of that yet. So I don't know. At this point, I'm not gonna give you a positive vote on this. I don't think it's the right time. I'm glad that we did this comparison. Whoever did it, thank you. But I just don't see an increase in fees right now as warranted. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Mr. Moreno. Mr. Castro.
In this item, I'm not in favor to increase the rentals. The rental rate for the community center and senior hall. I think and I believe there is some other resources or avenues that the city of Calexico can look for to get benefit for to to maintain the city hall, the community center and senior center hall. So I definitely I'm not agreed to increase. I know there's the majority of this city are gonna hurt them, because it looks like just $50, but $50 is $50 for them. So in this case, I'm not in favor to increase the rate for the senior, for the community center rent. That's it.
Thank you, Mr. Castro. Mr. Hutch?
And what's the capacity on that one? What's the capacity on that one? And then I know that we've gone to several events in El Centro at the old schoolhouse, Eucalyptus. Are you familiar how much that one charges? I know that one's fancier.
Well, it's fancier, and they charge quite a bit, and also you have to have it, you have to also, their liquor comes from their bar, so you can never have, like, open
bar. It's just different.
You have to pay for that. Plus, also, the food has to come from them, and the music has to come from them. So you pay it for a full package. It's very expensive.
Well, I know that the city of Calexico does provide several opportunities for many of the residents to have, or for organizations, for example, to have it free of charge. There's discounts for different groups, or I believe senior citizens. And personally, I've already, my family and my friends are going through a lot of the quinceañeras and events like that. And I know that a $50 increase is really not much. So personally, I don't see it really, considering that it is a cost of living increase, as a very, I believe it's a fair amount. So I would vote in favor.
Thank you, Mayor Pro Tem Hurtado. To begin with, nobody wants fees to be increased, no matter the service. The community center and the senior hall under the community services budget directed by Senator Toller, $50, as you put it, Mr. Castro, is $50. It's incredible how many events are held during the city of Calex for the at the community center and senior hall. In the senior hall, what the $50 could contribute to Director Toller's budget. Now, can the city look at other ways to generate funds for the general fund? Yes. This would be a direct impact, if I'm not mistaken, City Manager Rodriguez, that this would be a positive impact for additional resources that Director Senator Toller requires in order to conduct her business on a day-to-day. She has the Cultural Arts Center to look after, the Carnegie Library, the Recreation Center, and the Kiki Camarena Library. You take away from one of them, or you don't give to one of them, it's going to impact the director on the other department, on the other areas. I heavily favor the increase of $50. And I do not understand from everything that this council has asked. Recreation, you need to do more. Library, education, you need to do more. You need to do more. But now you're saying, I want you to do more, but I'm not going to give you any more. It's, you know, you mentioned about the affordability to the families. I agree with you, $50 in that regard is $50. But if you're going to hold an event like this, the $50, they're going to spend it elsewhere, because you're not just renting the recreation center. You're going to go contract the food. You're going to go contract the music. You're going to go contract this. You're going to go contract that. So in that regard, if they can rent the community center for $600, I really do believe that they can afford the $650. One of the things and the issues with nonprofit organizations, including the senior citizens, they have Measure H that they can go to. Well, the nonprofit, they have the use of the facility for once a year without paying this full amount. So that's not an issue. And they rent it quite a few times during the course of the year. So these are events that the recreation center or the community center is not receiving any income. The senior citizen groups that are out here, they can rent it for once a year without having to pay anything. If they want to do a second event, they can always approach Measure H saying, hey, this thing, Measure H is about public safety, it's about recreation, and it's about senior citizens. That's where the concept was sold. So if they're able to have access to the additional $50, I would really like to see how much more of a success Director Toller can have with those additional $50 per event. So be it. I do, again, I'm very much in favor of it. So in that regard, I will extend myself and motion for its approval. Anyway, you have my motion. Is there a second?
Yes, I'll second.
For discussion, when would we revisit the possibility of raising it? Just once a year, every 6 months?
Well, we really should be looking at these fees on an annual basis. Unfortunately, this particular fee we haven't raised in 3 years, you know, just for the cost of living. And again, there was a purpose of not coming back and increasing the rental amount. It was just simply to try to keep up with the cost of living because, as you know, these facilities are getting older and they require more work. And so, but yeah, we should revisit them probably at least once a year, if not every other year. We tried not to come back only because the economy's bad. We all understand that. But at the same token, we need to take care of our facilities, and we need to give the department heads the ability to work with their budgets. And we're asking them to do more, and yet, you know, we keep cutting back on their revenues.
Mr. Senator?
Yes. Originally, this thing came up because Senator Toller was asking me to help her with the facilities because she ran out of her janitorial budget. So we tried, and unfortunately, it wasn't working out that well. So we came up with some other ideas to try to help her out. Again, I had to give some of my resources in order to help her, help the seniors, help the community. So this goes beyond what you see, just $50. $50 is for janitorial services that we're trying to address. So it is coming out of my budget right now, but it is a problem that needs to be addressed.
All right, and since this is an impact to the Kiki Camarena Library as well, and education is a primary concern for all citizens, enough has been said by members of the council. A motion is made, and there's a second. Please vote. Okay, a disappointing 2-3. Next item. Enterprise fund, it's a consent calendar. There's one item that I will pull, number 19. Is there a motion to approve number 18?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, Councilor Moreno approved a motion, second by Mayor Pro Tem Hurtado. Please vote. Thank you. 5-0. Number 19, it's an issue of, I've always requested it from all the time that I've been here in this council, any time that there's agreements, change order, or whatsoever you being placed, that that the packet include that there is a business license in effect with the City of Calexico. Just a moment ago, City Manager Rodriguez furnished me a copy that they do have one in file. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
That is correct.
And it's ineffective till December 31st, 2012. Again, I'm asking city manager and staff to always have that as part of your presentation, because the question will come up, and that's one less question that can be asked. So I'll go ahead, motion for its approval, number 19. Is there a second? Motion by yours truly, second by Mr. Moreno. Please vote. Okay, 5-0. Informational items, speeding complaint to City Council reference Emerson Avenue.
Well, basically, these are informational items, so we want to provide you the information that was requested. If there's questions, we're happy to answer them. Otherwise, we have the information that's been provided to you.
Thank you. Any comments by council or acknowledge
your seat? No, I kind of brought this up a while back, and I'm glad it finally got up to our attention. So we'll see what this study does. Thank you, Chief.
Okay, thank you. 21, report in attendance for all city boards and commissions. Council members, you have the reports that were provided. Any questions or comments? Nope?
Nope.
Acknowledge receipt?
Acknowledge receipt.
Future agenda items. Mr. Hodge. Yes, I just threw a curve. Break the monotony.
Well, I do appreciate finally the attendance on our commissions. But I would like to, on the next agenda, request a possible ordinance or resolution, whichever is appropriate, that commissions and boards and advisory committees, that they on a mandatory basis in a timely manner, and that can be worked out in the staff's end, or at least quarterly, number one, submit attendance records on meetings being held and on also individual attendance. Number two, for every entity, minutes must be submitted to City Council. And number three, which I really appreciate, is informative, a short oral report presentation given on a rotating basis. I don't know the legality of this, but that's my request, if it's all possible. Why? The rationale is that, in my strong opinion, commissions are very important arm of our local government. If they're consistent, if they're structured and operating properly, they can make a big difference in the effectiveness of our city government and its positive impact on the community. So I very strong on our commissions and our boards and advisory. They're not a rubber stamp kind of entity. They do a great deal of legwork. And they and each and every one of us must be held accountable. It's just a matter of strengthening the system, putting it in a more firm place. So that's my request for that. On another note, that's sort of interrelated. I don't think I did this right last time. I need to make an appointment for the Financial Advisory Committee. And that's it for me, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Hodge. To break the monotony, Mr. Moreno.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. During the summer months, we usually waive the parking fees, and that has not been brought up. I'm not sure where the bid stands on that, but I know that's up for discussion. Here we are, first week of June, and I know that that puts a damper on
during the summer
revenue, right? As I recall, we did or we did not. I think we did last year allow July and August. So just get information, maybe put this on the agendas of some of the commissions to see how they stand and what their desires are, specifically the bid. and see what the...
So you're asking to put this before the bid and see what their comments are?
Right. And perhaps maybe even the chamber or you know, our business entity groups. That way we don't have to react later on and we plan for it. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Mr. Moreno. I hope that if there is a consensus to do something like this, that they would approach Measure H before for some measure of support, instead of taking it away from the general fund resources. Mr. Castro.
Yes, for the future agenda, I would like to open the position for Recreation Department and also a Street Naming Committee. So please, City Clerk, can you publicize that those commissions for the next public council meeting? That's it.
Thank you. Mayor Pro Tem Montalvo.
Well, now that we're talking about commissions, then I guess I need to appoint a beautification commissioner. And I hate to do this, but being that the increase to the fees for the community center was defeated today, maybe we should look at our airport fees for our rentals of our hangars. Maybe a little bit of information of what's going on out there. I know that there's sales that happens at the airport. We sell fuel and in the times that I've been at the restaurant, I still see some activity, even though I've had comments that the activity has died down quite a bit in the years. But it'd be interesting to know, especially after our visit with FAA. I was just curious to know what the status is out there, if we're making any money. And specifically those hangars to see what, because I don't think those rates have been raised for a while either. And I believe that's it.
Yeah, the airport is barely hanging on, and that's not unusual. I've run two airports, one in Raleigh, one here, so they're hard to run. But
sure, but we'll
take a look at that.
I don't think we've ever heard any report other than looking at their budget.
Sure.
So I think it would be worthwhile to keep them busy. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor Pro Tem Hurtado. I have in the past requested reports on the business license fees, and it never took into consideration to ask a question, and now I will. Are the fire department fees included in the fire department fees? I mean, in the business license fees? Mm-hmm. I presume no?
The answer is no.
Then I would look, since the second meeting of the month is a meeting where you would be listing the fees that are due by the businesses, the business license fees, I would also ask you to include the fire department fees that are owed. Let me see here. I'm also, the trash cans presentation. We need a clarity on the language of the ordinance and why someone would receive a citation the very next day versus a warning, etc. I've also been waiting for a presentation of the Adopt a Park program. I understand the Recreation Commission received that presentation. There's been three parks have been adopted. Is that correct, Mr. Servin? I would like to still have that presentation before the council. All right, now, what's that? Yes. Yes, not at the next meeting, okay? The first meeting in July.
Nothing's happening at the next meeting, obviously.
City Manager Rodriguez, you mentioned something a little while ago, and it reminded me, and which has been requested before, any discussion regarding the RDA as it was evolving into the city of Calexico? Presentations were made, graphs were shown. This is the line base for what all the agencies will get, and the RDA will get above that. Are you familiar with those presentations?
When we had an RDA, is that what you're talking about?
Yes, when the city of Calexico was entertaining the possibility of expanding the RDA zone, they were talking about all the benefits, how the RDA would secure more additional funds.
Correct.
Okay. With the RDA going away, we've never really seen a presentation on the reverse process, because the RDA is going away, or went away.
Yes, okay. It's no longer.
I would welcome a presentation how this impacts the city of Calexico. In other words, before, if there was $100,000, then this was divided in this manner, and quite a bit of money going to RDA. Now with RDA gone, I believe that you need to educate the council and the citizens how this impacts the city of Calexico, either positively or negatively. Now, my first thought is that you'll be receiving additional revenues in a general fund, obviously at the expense that there will be no RDA funds coming in.
There may be, in the first couple of years, we're not sure that there will be any funds coming in, because there's certain obligations that need to be taken care of, and the top priority is the payment of bond servicing of debt service. So there's a real possibility the first couple of years there won't be any money coming in to the RDA, or to the former RDA, actually to the city.
To the general fund.
To the city. And so that's going to be difficult, and to you know, we can certainly expound on a future meeting in reference to the impacts with the elimination of RDA, but the impacts are negative. I mean, there's just no positive, other than there, at this point, there is a $250,000 amount that is provided for administration for the administering of the elimination process for the RDA. So basically, we've traded off millions of dollars for $250,000. We haven't traded it off. The governor took it away from us and stole it from us. And that's what really happened, because obviously we all know what the situation is with the state, them going from $9 billion deficit to $16 billion deficit and growing every time that we look at what the deficit is. And so they are literally raping any and all funds that are available out there. And certainly we have taken our hits. There is currently a trailer bill that is moving through the legislature by the Department of Finance that basically makes the Department of Finance, and is being presented by the administration, that provides the Department of Finance for being judge and jury, so that any appeals that we may have on the oversight board as to how we use the funds that we do have available to us under the law, that in fact they would make the final decision, and we had absolutely no appeal rights. And so we're fighting it, the league is fighting it, we'll see where that ends up going, but it's getting ugly and it's getting really tough. It's getting really tough. So yes, we'd be happy to present something on that, so everybody understands that one of our major tools for moving development and assisting some of the social service processes, such as, you know, we assisted things from neighborhood house to social services in reference to the women's shelter, to the chamber, to, you know, a lot of other agencies, those are gone. We have no ability to do that anymore, even in our economic development tools, such as our enterprise zone and our foreign trade zone. Now, that's going to have to be funded through their general fund. So as our general fund is shrinking, we're having to pick up more of the load. So it's getting tough. And I think that where we're headed as organizations, municipalities, as we're going to have to look at shrinking our organizations and being more effective and efficient, and looking at contracting out certain services, I think that's where we're headed. And so we need to look at any and all opportunities. Tonight you passed the voluntary incentive separation program. I've been told that there are four or five employees that will take us up on that. Part of the program is that we don't hire back these employees in these positions. So it's going to get harder as we move down the road, but I think we have to do that in order to make sure that our house remains fiscally stable. No easy decisions, you know, no easy decisions to be made or recommendations to come. But I think that's what we're facing in the future. So we'll be happy to provide that.
Yes, please, because there is a perception that the general fund is going to be growing pretty soon. So thank you. We're not going to adjourn the meeting. We're going to go into closed session. We'll adjourn afterwards. Thank you.